Bonjour, everyone. Welcome to tonight's show. You're listening to the Temple of Aset, the teachings of Shitout Netter Internet Radio Blog Show. My name is Ampu Waset, and I'm your host for tonight, and I say greetings to all of you in the live and tape broadcast listening audience. This is the Rec Ab Wisdom Teaching Shetty Discipline of Shitout Netter. What will be shared on this show are the ancient philosophical and religious teachings from ancient Kemet, which lead to transformation of the heart, which is the soul. Priests and priestesses of the Temple of Aset, as well as Dr. Mawada Ashby, Sebai Ma, and Dr. Karen Clark Ashby, Sebai Ja, teachings which, when practiced, transform the heart. This transformation is one, from mortal consciousness to eternal consciousness, from animal consciousness to spiritual consciousness, from consciousness of the physical body and mundane reality to consciousness of the body of light called the Aku, based upon the ancient African Kemetic tradition known as Shitout Netter. This show has been developed as a means to assist you with the Netterian practices which open the way to this mental transformation. Tonight we continue the weekly Saturday evening Rec Ab Wisdom Teaching Show. 2 weeks ago, we completed the reflections of the members of the temple that went with us on the spiritual pilgrimage to the ancient site of Kemet. That was in June 2015 this year. At that time, Dr. Mawada Ashby, Sebai Ma, began sharing his reflections from the pilgrimage. Tonight, he will continue to share with us his reflections because 2 weeks ago, he only did 1 hour of a show of reflections, and tonight he will continue sharing those with us tonight. The title of this new series of shows is the Reflections from the Spiritual Pilgrimage to Kemet, the Resurrection of Osar, Reflections from the Spiritual Pilgrimage to Kemet, the Resurrection of Osar. So dua, which means adoration, which we also use to say thank you for joining us tonight. We hope that you enjoy tonight's discourse. For those of you who do not know about us, the Temple of Aset is dedicated to the dissemination of the universal teachings of spiritual evolution, which relate to the union of humanity and the union of all things within the universe. While we recognize the unifying principles in all spiritual and religious systems throughout the world, our primary goal is to provide the wisdom of ancient spiritual teaching from the Neterian culture of ancient Africa, which is known as Shetout Neter. Shetout Neter means hidden divinity. And now, with that introduction done, I am now going to bring on the guest for this evening, Sebai Ma, who will be sharing with us his reflections from the pilgrimage. And with that, I say, Uja, Sebai Ma, your microphone is on. Peace and blessings to you. How are you doing this evening? It's up.
Uja, greetings. Can everyone hear me?
I hear you well. Very well. Come back. Also.
Uja, likewise. And I'll refer everyone again to the website where the slides are, which is www.egyptianyoga.com/trip to Kemet. Just give a few minutes for everyone to, or a minute or so for everyone to go there.
www.egyptianyoga.com/ what now, Sebai?
Trip to Kemet. It's all together. Trip to Kemet.
Kemet is spelled out K-E-M-E-T?
T-R-I-P-T-O-K-E-M-E-T. EgyptianYoga.com/trip to Kemet. When you get there, you go...
Go ahead, Sebai.
The menu. You go to the menu, and you go to the page where it says images from the pilgrimage to Kemet, summer 2015.
For those of you who are listening in by way of the chat room, can you hear me and Sebai also? A tap?
I guess my page is taking a long time to load. Okay, here it is.
One of the people on the chat room, they've already got there, so it's working well with them.
Yeah, it's probably one of those things that I probably need to close, you know, restart the computer. I haven't restarted for a while, so. But I think I have it. And so on this page, there's a slide presentation. I'll keep on adding slides as we go along, so we should have one more presentation after this one next Saturday, and we should be going through the main sites of everything that was, not every single thing that was seen, but the main, like the gist, the maut, or the main moral of the story, the takeaways. Of course, you have to go, you have to really get the depth of it and see things in person as well, and that's all of that there. But we have, I thought some of the most important and interesting things from each site, or at least two things, let's put it that way, at least two of the most important things, I would say, from each site that are appropriate for this kind of venue. And also on this page, there's a slide presentation. And then below that, there's a a video playlist. So you should be able to see the video from last time, the first presentation. And when we finish tonight, I'll be saving this one, so then there'll be two videos in the playlist. And when we do the third one, then I'll add the third one to the playlist. And the same slides will apply to the videos as well. Okay.
Sounds good. I'm up. I've got the slides up. Those of you in our chat room listening audience, if you could see where they are. Okay. Those of you listening in by way of the chat room, I see one of you, the link has worked well. How about the others? Are you up now also, Hatap? Okay, the majority who is listening in, they're up with the video, the link also, Sebai, Hatap.
Okay, very good. So I'm going to start where we left off last time, which is where we had just arrived at the Temple of Aset. So I'm going to skip through the slides to that point. I believe it starts at about slide 8, or I'm not sure what I'm using a new system for the slides, but the one that is currently numbered 8 has the first view of the Temple of Aset. The temple is on an island, and we have to get on a small boat, and so there are two pictures on the slide. The bottom of the slide has a picture of our group on the boat, and we're all looking at the temple in the distance, which is on the bottom left. And then the picture above is as we're getting closer, from the same direction. And then I have a series of slides that are of an approach. So, we're not going to look at them individually. These are kind of series. So we'll be maybe slide 9, 10, 11, 12. 12 was a nice one. We have it was a completely clear sky, and the sun was directly above the temple. Now in 13, this is kind of where we left off. We are inside the temple, and I have some pictures of the outside, but we're going, kind of straight to the inside. I believe this is the Holy of Holies, and we're discussing how here the king, or the pharaoh, the Petah, is making an offering to Asar, who is being protected by Ankara-Saset, who is in her winged form. And if you look directly above my right shoulder, you can see that Asar is in his mummy form, and Aset is embracing him with her wings. And it's one of the poses of the Jeff Netru system as well. And everyone surrounding there is part of the group who went on the trip. This particular room, this Holy of Holies room, the sanctuary, we're going to be doing a special study of two of the scriptures that occur in this room for our new class, the Teachings of the Temple of Aset. And from listening to the group of the Shems and the Asars and the new that came before me on the series. Very probably this temple was the most impactful of all the temples. Perhaps it's because it's on an island. Perhaps it's because of the quality of the reliefs and the nature of the relief, the energy of the architecture, the visual energy, the psychic energy. We had a wonderful opportunity to go come to this temple twice. We went in the day and also during the night. And let me move forward to the next slide. I'm going to show the number here, 14. Here we went to visit a chapel. And this is a chapel dedicated to the goddess Heteru. So the temple complex has several chapels and several special rooms, and we're going to see another one in a minute. And when we get to this will not be this time. Next time, in the final show, we'll look at the temple of Heteru. And Heteru is also a temple complex, and within her complex, she has a set chapel. So the temple of Aset has a Heteru chapel. Heteru has an Aset chapel. And someone was, I was talking to someone, I believe it might have been a Kuwa or someone we were talking about as we were leaving the Heteru temple. And what is happening is that the Neteru are life forces. They are energies. And you can think of it as the size of a relief or a statue relates to the prominence of the energy that you are projecting in your iconography, in your architectural iconography. And so in the Temple of Aset, Aset is the main energy. Aset is a motherly energy. Aset is a wisdom energy. Aset is the energy of relentless pursuit of the loved one and putting back together that which has been torn apart by Set, primarily by the ego. And so in the Temple of Heteru, you have the energy of Heteru, which is main, but you have a little spice. Like in this one, you have a little spice. And so the spice in the Aset temple is the Heteru. And Heteru is the feline, the leonine energy. And she's also a more kind of gross aspect of life force. Gross in a standpoint of that is more earthy, it is more physical, it is more, how should we say, passionate. And so you have a little bit of that spice in the Aset temple. And in the Heteru temple, you have the opposite. You have more of the strong life force, and then you have the spice of Aset, which is the thoughtfulness, the gentleness, the motherliness. And we can discuss a little bit more of that when we get to the Heteru temple. But anyway, here we are in the Heteru chapel of the Aset temple, and this is recounting the teaching of the golden cow or of the eye. Yeah, there are different renditions of the same story where Heteru gets lost in the world of time and space, and Lord Jehuti, her uncle, helps her to come back, helps her to rediscover who she was. And in this chapel, we found some wonderful holograms also. And we can talk about that a little bit, but I'm reserving the conference in December to do a more detailed presentation of holograms. And I'm actually doing preparing some holographic animations so that everyone can see in a very exact what we refer to, what we mean by hologram. Actually, it's a more detailed definition is a holographic conversions. But I'll reserve that discussion more for December, our conference in December, and we're going to show a few slides. They take a while to prepare. They're kind of in a way more. They're not necessarily more complicated to prepare, but they're more difficult, right, in a sense of time consumption and other ways. So they take a while. So we'll probably have about 4 or 5 to show. And I think that should be, you know, very interesting and anticipation for everyone to look at. So I'll move on from here, from slide 4, and we'll go forward. There a noise there? What happened?
That was me sneezing, Sebai.
All right. Well, take some vitamin C.
Do
that. And some elderberry and some echinacea tea, and we can go on and on with that. Garlic. I'm moving on to slide number 15. I guess the numbering system kind of went off on these. This is a picture on the right side. Is a Sarasetna, Uapsetna, who is, and our group is standing behind me. I think I took this picture, and we're looking at the Imhotep, which is also an infirmary, and it's also a pharmacy. And we did a special commemoration here. On the top left of the picture, I'm not sure I discussed this before, but you can see the discoloration of the stones where it looks black. And that is where the you know, I was discussing with the dams. That is where the water level had risen to that level. And you can see the remnants. They try to clean it up, but you see that remnants of that all the way around the temple. Something which is, you know, which was extremely foolish and idiotic to do, you know, to destroy the existing reliefs and the coloring and the paint of the temple and so on and so forth. But that's a kind of a different discussion. At this location is where people would have come for healing, and directly facing, if you walk directly facing away from this chapel, you would go to the entrance of the temple, to the entrance of the temple complex, where you have the dock and everything like that, or one of the docks. So that wasn't necessarily the ancient one. There's another one on the other side that we did not see, you know, for time issues, but it had a kind of portal and everything. And on a previous visit, we did a special commemoration there, but that was, you know, several years ago on a trip that I went. But anyhow, so people would come here for healing. They would come here for diagnosis and for medicine. And that is you can walk through the doors, and you go to the back, the interior portion of the pharmacy, and, you know, where herbs were kept, the medicines, and so on and so forth. Moving on to the next slide. This would be like 16. I guess I have to fix the numbering system on these. The numbering did not come out. But I'll describe them anyway. Here, we can see, this is on the other side of the temple. These are all buildings on the outside of the temple. And we're not discussing all of them because of, you know, for time's sake and so on, but this is kind of an important area. This is an image of, and I've shown this in our presentations, like the Asari Resurrection Conference, I think it's 2009, and 2007, the Temple of Set, Teaching of the Temple of Set. I guess it would be a volume one. And this is a picture of the crocodile god Sobek, and on his back is the mummy, the mummified body of Asar. And so Sebek is carrying the mummified body of Asar, there's a section of the myth of the Asar resurrection where Asar's body was thrown into the Nile, and then it came to rest in the land now called Syria, Byblos, and then it grew into the body, the coffin grew into out of it grew a tree, and so it was in the trunk of a tree. Then, make a long story short, Aset found it, and Sebek helped her by carrying the body back to Kemet. And so here, in stone relief iconography, you see the imagery of the myth being carved, longevity. And in the same room, you have the Pillar of Asar in another section. This is the same area where the guy was telling us that they found the final writing, that the last hieroglyphic writing of Kemet, and which he was showing us that they were writing, the Romans are coming and they're killing us. Essentially, it was the Roman Christians, the fanatic Christians. They were trying to stop all religions other than Christianity at that time. But that's another story. For that, you can go to Mystical Journey from Jesus to Christ, where that is discussed more fully, and also African Origins, Volume 2. So we're going to the next slide. So that was the day trip, the day visit to the Temple of Aset. And then we returned during the evening. We went there at night also. And this was the first time for me going at night. I've been there several times during the day. But this was a special kind of treat. So we took the boat again. And go to the next slide. Make this will work here. And there was a light show. And the light show, the most important and most wonderful part of the light show was the light. And they have a kind of narrative that goes with it. You can get, now you can get, they didn't used to have this. You have to go to a particular show that has your language and they have with loudspeakers but now they have like they do in museums, they have radio transmitters that everyone can wear individually with your language, synchronized with the light show. The best thing you can do, which is what I did, the best thing you can do is to go to a show that has a different language than yours and to throw away the transmitter, the radio, with the earbuds and all that. Just forget it. Idiotic. It's foolish. And any other kind of epithets I can use or definitions I can use for the stupidity of the narrative of what is said, speculative foolishness and nonsense about Cleopatra or about Caesar or about all kinds of foolishness. And so that would be my best advice. Go to the line to, if you don't know French, go to the French one. If you don't know English, go to the English one. So you can hear the drama in the words and how the actors are reading it and saying it, and it gives you a nice kind of dramatic feeling. But you won't hear the foolishness that's being said, and the nonsense and the utter. And they'll have a wonderful experience. So the lights are just spectacular. That they really did a good job on that. I'll give them that. Being there at night, especially in Kemet, because you have an open sky, you have the clarity of the environment because you're not close to the city. And the noise, and so on and so forth, and you get to Yeah, this is the picture that I'm showing now is the second open court. There are two open courts. This is the second. And to the left is the birth house, which is one of my favorite rooms of the temple. And you see images of Peru being born and so on and so forth. And so this is the second pylon, and if you walk through there, you go into the hypostyle hall. And beyond the hypostyle is the Holy of Holies, where we were, the picture we showed at the beginning. I'm going to move over to the next slide. The next slide has a picture of the temple at night. And this is, once you walk through the temple, you come through the front of the temple, you walk through, then you come out to the side, and you walk, you come out to the far right side of this picture. And you come out to on the side where the Heteru Chapel was, where we saw him in the day. Then you walk to where there are a set of seats and watch. And so I had the opportunity to take lots and lots of pictures with a new camera that I got, which specifically for this purpose, to be able to take pictures in low light. And it worked out extremely well. And this is one of the pictures. And so as I was discussing with several people who were there, the lighting of the most authentic lighting that you would see is the orange ones that reproduce a kind of fire effect. I think what is most authentic, although I think that also for our modern time, the color lighting effects, especially if they're used in conjunction with the wisdom of sound and light and oils, incense for the smells, the correct smells, and so on and so forth, will help to, along with the architecture and the iconography, will help to stimulate a powerful spiritual effect, a psycho-spiritual effect. And so I think that is a legitimate and useful purpose. And I think that this is, you can imagine the festivals that occurred where, as you can see, the two pylons, the room that we're in was in between the two pylons. So the pylons are the two tall, how should we say, towers that flank both sides of the temple. And the center is the main door. And so you have two pylons. And outside the first one, you have the first open court or peristyle hall. And then you have a second peristyle area with the birthing house. And then you move into the hypostyle area, and then beyond that is the Holy of Holies area. So moving to the next slide now. If it'll come on. Taking a long time to let up my screen on for bar. Let me refresh the page and see what that helps. Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and open up on a separate. I'll keep on looking at it there. All right. So the next slide has an image of all of us together sitting in a table. This is at the hotel in the city of Aswan. And this was interesting we had apparently, as we found out later, we had the entire city to ourselves, as we were told by the guide, and there apparently there were there, at this point they were starting to go on high alert because there were some issues that were occurring in Libya and in Tunisia. That I think there was another terrorist attack, and then we were told that we're the only people with American passports in the whole city at that time. So there was concern that there would be special interest paid to our presence, so put it that way. And that was the city of Aswan. And I believe after this, the next slide, we went on a boat ride, which is it's not really a felucca. Felucca is more of a sailboat, but this is more of a small boat that we went cruising on the Nile. And this is a picture of, I think all of us got in there. You can see the cruise ships in the background and the Nile River behind us. And during that ride on the Nile, we saw. I think we got to the first cataract, which is where you have the rocks coming up, where it gets shallow in the Nile River. But we got to see a lot of marshy areas, a lot of areas that that recalled the Assyrian resurrection myth, how the goddess of Set was hiding. When she found the body of Assar, she was hiding in the tall papyrus marshes. And then, we saw how they're so tall that it seems like you could actually hide in there. And so the story of the Assyrian resurrection has many aspects that relate to real life, and that relate to a kind of life process that is approachable by ordinary human beings, and that is what it's meant to be. The sermon of resurrection, the story of Asara sitting in her room, sounds a mythic teaching of mainly five personalities that came into existence in the Anunian creation myth. And the five personalities are, I'm not going into detail, but the five personalities are the personalities of that, or the they constitute elements that put together a human being. And that's the Star, Set, Set and Nebhet, and Heru Ur. So Asar is a person's soul. Aset is a person's intuition or wisdom, person's identity, person's understanding of who they are. And then there is Set, who is the ego. And then there is Aset, that there is Nebhet, who is the physical personality, the physical aspect of personality, your body, your flesh and blood, your skin, your bones, and so on and so forth. And then you have Hirugur, who is your higher aspirational self. And all of that is in trouble or out of balance when Set takes control, when Set overshadows the other aspects of the personality. The ultimate aspect is Hirugur, and that is the one who should be in charge. And if a Heru-Ur is in charge, then there is a connection, a direct connection that opens up to Ra and to the transcendental self whom Ra arises out of. But that's a different teaching. That's a teaching of the tree of life and the Anuni creation myth and other things. Moving on to the next slide. So anyway, we kind of had a discussion. We recounted that slide where we had a picture of back on the boat. We're still showing the journey, and at one point we're giving the teaching, and then we did a musical, and I think everybody enjoyed the section where we did the. And I think that there might be a little bit of a video of this, or at least a recording of this. We'll have to do a little search, but I think there is something, and that was very enjoyable, and I enjoyed it very much. And although everyone will maybe should take this jokingly, I would have preferred to have my own drum to play with, I think this is the person's drum. Because I think they were just another funny situation with this was that the drum was on top of the table that's right in front, which had some blankets on it. Now, underneath the blankets are some trinkets that they wanted to. And so their whole plan was to take us around, show us a few things, and then start opening up and pulling out the artifacts, the things that they wanted to sell. And of course, some of the participants already discussed some of this aspect, the commercialized aspect, and the fierceness of the constant selling and the constant pressure for backsheesh and for tips and essentially bribes and things like that. So anyway, we did the song, and we started doing the song. And it went on and on. And so then they started heading back. And I think they even did a little turn to see if I would finish stop singing. I'm not sure everybody knows this. But then they did a little turn around, and they went out back out to the water again and kind of turned them back around. And it so happened that the meter and the timing of the song as I was doing it ended when they actually gave up and they actually started docking us back on shore. Like in the background, I think it was between those two ships. I think one of those ships might be ours. But anyway, I thought it was a funny situation because I think he was a little upset that he didn't have more time to sell us stuff and all of that. But they started, pulling it out as we got in, and then people started, whoever wanted to look at it started looking. Anyway, I thought it was a funny situation. A silly situation, but you can go there and just relax and not be constantly accosted by. But anyway, regardless of all that, I think we still had a good time, which was positive. Now, the next image, this is still part of the. The boat ride. We're looking at a little island. They call it Elephantine Island. Actually there was a temple there to Kunun, and you can still go there, and you can see the remains, but mostly it's a foundation. This is. Part of the story of the famine, where it is told that a famine occurs that lasted for 7 years, and then the Perah started an investigation to find out what was going on, and he asked the council of priests and priestesses to investigate and find out what's going on. Why is the Nile not flowing, and it's not flooding the land so that there could be farming and so on and so forth. And so they came back to him and they told him that the god of the beginning of the Nile, which is this is the area of the beginning of the Nile in the Kemetic territory. Below this is the Sudan, and that's Kush territory, or Kash, the Kushite area. So they came back to tell the Prada that Kanum was not happy because the people of Kemet were not doing homage to him, which means doing homage to the Netheru, doing homage to righteousness and truth, and people were losing their way, and so they were being made to suffer. And so what that means is that the situation was that the country as a whole had gone into a kind of neglect. And this happens to societies over time, where they develop and they advance and they think that they're all that. They think that they are authors of their own prosperity, and they forget that they are flawed and that they rely on nature for survival and for prosperity. And so it's arrogance. So Kanum was teaching them a lesson. And when they reported back to the Pera what had happened, he issued his apologies, and he started to make offerings, you know, the 10% offerings that are to be made to the temple, and the Nile started flowing again, and Kanum was in Hetep. He was satisfied. He was happy at that point. And so a lot of Kemet, you can go to lots of places where you see the mythic teaching is actually embodied in architecture, embodied in physical places and physical buildings. And so you not only need to or have to live the mythic teaching in a book, but actually you can walk in it and touch it and sit on it and experience it, and so on and so forth. So that's one of the benefits of going to Kemet. The next slide is a picture of our sailboat, riverboat, let's call it that, cruise boat. And I thought I would just throw it in to give people a feeling or an idea of the journey as we're going through it. I guess it's called the Sarah. And it was comfortable, and we had they accommodated us in a vegetarian diet and things like that, so it's very good. The next stop, the next day, was the Heru and Sebek at Kom Ombo, and this is a very ruined temple. It's very, when I mean ruined, it means that it was dismantled, and the many of the stones were taken, just like they have been all over Egypt, taken to create people's houses. Since they were Muslim, they did not care, or Christians, they did not care about the ancient Egyptian tradition or temple. They're just reusing it. It had no other value to them. So this is our group there, posing in front of the Kom Ombo temple, and we are looking. If you walk through the temple has two divinities, so it has two sides. And going back to the previous slide, it has two doors, two main doors. It had the pylons, but the pylons are gone, and it's kind of to the right, and the person is, you know, sitting there on the left one, I believe. And so that two doors, it has two lintels over the doors, and two uwajit, the winged sun disc. If you walk into the left door, you'll find a room which is on the next slide, which is a kind of hypostyle area. And these are the columns that you see. And we are looking at one of the reliefs. And if you look on the next slide, you'll see the relief that we're looking at. It's a relief showing the para, or the king, being given the amulet of Ankh by Aset, who is in the goddess Aset, who is in a leonine form, also Heru is there, Lord Chahuti is there. And this is a special form of Heru of Komombo. And on the next slide, you can see a close-up look at the scene, which is the goddess giving the life force, the Ankh, to the Pera. The glyphs in between her hand and between the head of the Pera, who's on the left, these are the offerings. These are food and drink, and the Ankh and the Waz. The next slide, the picture did not come out so great, but I think you can still make it out, is the surgical instruments. And this is one of the famous, these are one of the famous scenes of the Kom Ombo temple. There are a couple of things, and this is one of them, that you have the imagery of actual surgical instruments that were used, that have been identified by modern surgeons and so on and so forth. On the next slide, we get back on the boat, and we had a wonderful kind of evening worship, and this was in the back of the on the top deck, towards the rear of the cruise boat. And I think that it's possible that there's a video recording of this as well. But I'll have to check and see where that is. It might not have all come out, but I think there are some. We try to record as much as possible. So we'll have to see about that. But that was nice. You can see in the distance looking towards the west. And on the other side of the boat, you know, we're sailing north, so you're looking to the west, and on the side behind the camera is the east, and to the right is the north, and to the left is the south. And on the next two slides, there are more pictures of that same evening. You know, showing as it was getting darker. And how it was nice to see the lights in the distance and so on and so forth. Quietness. Well, that's one of the things that you can do. Sebai and I have never taken a cruise ship on the Nile before. We have gone and we have stayed in a hotel, because you can stay in a hotel and do all the things. Usually people, if you do that, you go to Luxor, and then from there you go to Kom Ombo, you go to Edfu, you go to Dendera, you go to Abdu, or you can do a portion of sailing, and you can do stops. And so there are good parts of it and negative sides of it. One of the positive sides is that it's a very comfortable kind of way to go, and to be able to actually sit out at night, even till late, because it's a lot cooler, and so on and so forth. So that was very enjoyable. On the next day, we docked in the city of Edfu. We got to see the magnificent temple of the temple of Heru, as things stand today, probably has the most massive pylons. And so you're looking at the pylons there now. The pylons are the towers, as we discussed, and they symbolize the duality of existence. And the door symbolizes the singularity through which one must move. They also symbolize the horizon, and one must move mountains. They're called Akerui, also the two lion divinities, the two leonine divinities, and also Shu and Tefnut, in a way as well. And so, through that duality, one moves through non-duality or singularity through the single portal. And the door itself, the portal itself, has certain architectural and numeric measurement aspects that relate the door to the pylons, and in a architectural fashion relate the concept of duality and non-duality in a subliminal form to the subconscious mind. We discuss also the slats that you see, and there are two slats on either side of the pylon that had flags. So there were four flags that would be flying, and of course the whole front of the temple would be painted. It would be wonderfully colored, and so on and so forth. And some of it is still left. You can see some of the color still left in the lintel section with the uaji going across the top of the door. This is the open court side. You go into the peristyle hall, and then to the hypostyle area, and the Holy of Holies. This temple is also connected to the temple of Dendera that we're going to see next week. The Dendera temple, the architecture is very close. They're matching temples, essentially, and they face each other also. And the teaching is that every year, the goddess Heru would come on a pilgrimage, and so her statue or her image would be taken from the temple, and there would be some portion sailing and some portion procession coming down the Nile and so on and so forth, coming to visit. This is a ritualized idea of the annual festival of creation or of making life. And so what would happen is that the goddess would come to, and her statue would be placed in the Holy of Holies with the statue of Heru. And also other divinities would come from other temples around the country to help them, and so that their energies would come together in the Holy of Holies to create a new year, essentially, and mythically, and metaphorically, it is the coming together of the duality of existence, the tantric kind of symbolism, the male and the female. And that coming together produces the life of the continued existence of creation and the continued existence of a human being. And of course, if there is a union of the higher principle, the higher heteru principle, which is your passion and your life force energy, with your higher aspiration or spirit, then there is the higher aspect of life that is to be experienced, which is the life beyond the purely human existence. Now, on the next slide, if you go into the interior of the temple and you go to your left, you would walk to an enclosure wall. You can see part of the enclosure wall in the previous slide that shows the pylons on either side of the pylons. There's an enclosure wall that encloses the temple and shields it from the rest of the city. On the inside of that wall is a drama or a series of reliefs that relate the battle between the god Heru and the god Set. I'm going back to the Asan resurrection myth and talking about how Set had killed Asar, and then Set found the body and she revived it. She had a child with Asar, and the child went into hiding, of course, just like Jesus did, and just like Krishna did, because the evil king was trying to get them and kill them so he could stay the king. It's the same story in Christianity and in Hinduism that is being recounted here. In this relief, we see scenes of the battle, and we see Heru spearing Set, who is in different forms. He's in different sizes of forms of a hippopotamus and things of that nature. The important aspect that I've talked about several times before is the idea that he is spearing 10 times. And if you look at the tree of life of the Anunnan theology, you see that Heru occupies the 10th position. And these numbers are arrived at through the emergence of, in the actual hieroglyphic scripture itself, of the creation myth. The number of each divinity in accordance with their emergence from the primeval ocean on the behest of Ra, who gives rise to them. And Heru-Ur occupies the 10th position. So he's the number 10 divinity, and 10 is the highest number of the tree of life, of a position in time and space. The highest number in the heavenly realm or the Dua is the number 1, and beyond the number 1 is the infinity, is the Nebuchadnezzar, the Mehurt, the transcendental self. And so the idea is that all the petas are actually referred to as Heru's incarnate, or they are operating under the authority of being Heru. And so it means that a peta or a mastered human being is supposed to be a person who has achieved the position of number 10. And number 10 is the position of a person who has defeated Set. And they become the master of their life. So if you become a king or a queen, you are the master of that. Is the metaphoric aspect of the teaching. And of course, you can have a physical para, a king and queen, and so on and so forth. And that is a political as well as a secular position as well. But we are talking about the mythic and the mystic aspect of the teaching. And that is, this is the desirable aspect, because the secular aspect doesn't last, and in time and space, it's final. And you want something that is transcendental. And so there are many wonderful things in the temples, but you know, for time's sake and all that, we're just discussing, like I say, the highlights. And this is just one of the wonderful highlights that can be seen, and it should be something. We spent okay amount of time. Really, when I've gone there before, I've had to go there and just kind of run, because we went with a caravan, and then you have to kind of leave all together, and you're going on their schedule, because they want to go and get back, and you know, the people who are running it. And so, you know, there's too much to see, to go back, either more times or, you know, arrange to stay longer. So sometimes I've had there only an hour to look around, and I think we had a couple of hours, perhaps. So anyway, that was very enjoyable. And you get to see this mythic teaching being played out. We've shown line drawings of these so that it could be easily seen. And it's just a very interesting and wonderful relief. And there are so many wonderful reliefs. But I think some of the best ones are ones that tie into, for general consumption, the best ones I think are the ones that tie directly into the mythic wisdom, because the mythic wisdom is accessible by everyone. And then this to the temple itself physically, and it's something that people can easily understand, you know, just by looking at it. And some of the other things, you have to kind of more study and be more into it and spend more time with. But this is a very easy access. So if you want to take a brief break and do a station ID, I'll get something to drink, and then we can continue to the next slide.
Sounds good.
Okay, proceed. Yeah.
Okay. What's that? You're listening to the Temple of Aset, the teachings of Shatapneta Internet Radio Blog Show. My name is Ampu Waset, your host for this evening. Sebai Ma is continuing the reflection of the 2015 spiritual pilgrimage to the ancient sites of Kemet. Began approximately 2 weeks ago. He is finishing those up tonight, and he will present next week as well. And I believe he said earlier in the show that there would be next week and the Saturday afterward to complete his reflections. It's my understanding at that point that I think Sebai will be making her reflections of the spiritual pilgrimage herself. For those of you who are not aware, Shatapneta is an ancient philosophy and mythic spiritual culture that gave rise to the ancient Egyptian civilization. The ancient Egyptians were African peoples who lived in the northeastern quadrant of the continent of Africa. They were descendants of the Nubians, who had themselves originated from farther south into the heart of Africa at the Great Lakes region, the source of the Nile River. They created a vast civilization and culture earlier than any other society in known history, and organized a nation that was based on the concepts of balance and order, as well as spiritual enlightenment. These ancient African people called their land Kemet. The Temple of Aset was founded by Dr. Mawada Ashby, by Ma, and his wife, Dr. Karen Clark Ashby, Sebaja, and is headquartered in Miami, Florida. Sebai Ma is the author of over 60 books on the mystical teachings of Shatapneta. He is the head priest and spiritual preceptor of the temple. Sebaja is the head priestess and has edited many of these works in addition to writing 2 books of her own. For more information about these products and the teachings of Shatapneta, feel free to visit us at www.egyptianyoga.com. Again, That's www.egyptianyoga.com. In addition to this show, we also have other shows where we disseminate Unitarian teachings. Join us every Sunday morning at 8:30 a.m. Eastern Standard Time for our devotional morning worship service with Osar Jehudi Sayatep and Shem's Adi Medias Mahati. That's every Sunday morning at 8:30 a.m. Eastern Standard Time for our devotional morning worship service. Also join us on Thursday evenings at 8 p.m. for our evening devotional worship Bouchette at Sunset Services, also led by the Osar Jehudi Sayatep, but assisted on this evening with By Shimsu Baket Asura. Again, that's every Thursday evening at 8 p.m. for our evening devotional worship service. And of course, every Saturday night at 9 p.m. at this time, on this day, join us for this reflection series, which is occurring right now, but the wisdom teachings from the Hemu and Sebajat and Sebai Ma when the reflection series ends. Every Saturday night, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Well, it might be, I guess, Daylight Savings Time as well. Daylight Savings Eastern Time. And that's for all of the shows. And all those shows and services essentially are on the same Blog Talk link. If you are in Charlotte, North Carolina, or Atlanta, Georgia, you can worship with us in those areas. If you're in the Charlotte, North Carolina area, you can worship with us live every Sunday. And for information about the time and location, feel free to call either Uab Ratem at 704-780-2879. That's 704-780-2879, or Onudamunti at 704-968-6200, at 704-968-6200. And if you're in the Atlanta area, every Sunday, you can worship with us at 1083 Austin Avenue, Northeast, at the Little Five Points from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. More information about this service can be found by calling us at 404-522-2926. Again, that's every Sunday, 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. at 1083 Austin Avenue Northeast at the Little Five Points. Feel free to give us a call at 404-522-2926 for more details about that. And the announcement by Maspoke in his sections earlier, and he mentioned our conference, our Winter Unitarian Conference. Well, it is fastly approaching. It will take place Thursday, December 31st, 2015, and it will run through Sunday, January 3rd. We are accepting registrations right now for the conference. Early bird registration fee is $400, and that amount is due on or before November 1. That's the standard registration fee. After November 1, the registration fee increases to $465. That $400, early bird registration, and $465 after that is for one person, and it includes three meals a day. It includes all of the sessions. It includes a definite to-do, meditation, and lodging as well. Final announcement for tonight is our request for a $5 monthly donation to support this and our other shows. This can be done on our PayPal account by doing a subscription. The PayPal account is ChitoutRetreat@AOL.com. That's ChitoutRetreat@AOL.com. For those of you who previously supported us in this way, again, we say do it to you, which again, we use to say thank you. Includes our announcements for for this evening. Let's have.
Pooja, do you hear me?
I can hear you well, Sebai, I can. Definitely.
Okay, very well. Okay, so now we're leaving the Temple of Heru at the city of Edfu, and we're going now to the city of Luxor, or Wazet. This is the city of the teaching of Theban theology related to the wisdom of the divinity Amun, which is also related to Amun-Ra and also to Ansu. And again, there are many details, so we're not going into, we just can highlight, but on this slide, the following slide, we have a picture of us again, all posing in front of the Luxor Temple. And I will get the numbering system again fixed for the next time. But this is the slide that is after the wall relief of the Battle of Heru and Set, where Set was Heru was spearing Set 10 times, and he's on a boat. He's also assisted by his mother, goddess of Set, and there's several things going on. Pera is there assisting and making offerings and such. So on the next slide, we have a picture of the Luxor Temple. And this is an image that has two pylons and one obelisk on the left. And perhaps for next time, I'll see if I can find a reconstructed, but you can see these online also, a reconstructed version of the temple, how it would have looked when it was fully operational and painted and fully constructed, as opposed to being in a ruined state that was reconstructed as it is now. Even with all of that, it's still possible to see the grandeur and the artistry of the perfection of how a temple can reflect the timeless principles of human existence, the measures of the proportions of creation of the human body, the regions of the temple reflecting regions of the portions of the body, and I'm going to show my favorite areas of this particular temple. So right here, where we're standing on this picture, we are standing in front of the main pylon, and there's a causeway that links this temple to another temple called Karnak, which is possibly the largest and most extensive surviving, outside of Saqqara, which you're going to see next time. Karnak is just massive, and the things that have survived there. So this causeway leads or connects these two temples, and there was a ritual that was performed each year, where there was a procession that proceeded to go through the it made a kind of circuit whereby the divinity would be taken from Luxor to the Nile, and then a little boat ride to the Nile, and go to the dock of the Karnak Temple, and then it would return by land through the causeway. And so that's a very thing aspect, the circuit aspect I'm talking about right now, of how the circuit that I'm relating this to the circuit of the human body, the life force energies that course through the human body as well as through the world itself. It causes the magnetic field, and it causes the aura of the human body, and so on and so forth. So you know, there are many interesting aspects of that that we could get into, but we're not going to get into. And I didn't really discuss that there per se. You know, there are so many other things that were being discussed. It was so abundant in possible teachings that can be given. And so let's proceed to the, well, first of all, the pile, the obelisk that you see here on the picture. First of all, there should be two obelisks. And when we go to the Karnak Temple next week, you may be, I think we have a picture of the one of the obelisks from the that was put up by the Pera Hatshepsut, the queen, and you can I'll leave that discussion for next time for that one. But basically, there should be two, and one of them was removed and taken to Europe, so there should be two on either side, and basically. Obelisks are a kind of tuning fork, if you can think of it that way. It is composed about how the pink granite is has certain properties that allow it to accumulate and conduct a certain form of radiation, certain forms of radiation. Now, coupling that with a vibratory effect of the tuning fork effect of the obelisk, you can imagine that if you were to walk in between the two of these massive tuning forks, what the vibrations and radiations would or could possibly be. And so I'll leave that for the imagination right now. You're walking through the obelisk, the two obelisks. You can imagine the two splats there with four flags flying. You have the, they don't look so big from here, but they're massive sitting statues. And there would have been more of them than what is there. Walking the pylons and the door, the top of the door is missing. So we're going to go in, on the next slide, we're going into the temple proper. And here we're looking, at, on this side, we're looking at the one of the open courts. This is the first open court, and we're looking towards the entrance. So we've entered the pylons, now we're looking towards the direction that we came in. So this picture is precisely to show the symbol of the Reiki. This is a one of the style area, and there's directly facing the pylon. There is a directly facing the camera on the pylon. There is a picture of what looks like a basket. That's the best way to describe it. It's a net symbol, it means palm. And then there's a bird standing on it or sitting on it, and he has arms outstretched. And he's pointing to the solar divinity, you know, which would be Amun-Ra. And so it means that the Reki, or the ordinary reverential personalities would have been allowed to come into the temple to this area. And we usually relate the concept of the Reiki as common folk. What it means is that they are not clergy, but they do have to be reverential. They do have to be, you can't be unrighteous. In other words, you can't be just any old street person and just come in to a sacred area. And so this is a, where the, you see the people walking there, this person, a lady, I believe, with a red shirt on, and a gentleman, on her right, our left, who has a vertical stripe on his shirt and jeans and so on and so forth. They are actually in the walking in the main axis of the temple. If they were to walk straight, to our left from this picture, they would be going to the Holy of Holies. So it gives you an idea of where we are in the temple. Now, on the next slide, I'm going to give one of my favorite areas. There are several areas. These are just a couple of them. On the next slide, actually, there's a close-up of the Reiki bird. And on the next slide is a slide from the birthing rooms. There are actually two birthing areas in this temple. And one is for the physical birth, and another is for the spiritual birth. And this is the spiritual birth. And what this means is that there is a, if you see here, the two divinities that are sitting here, actually one of them is the mother of the Perah, or the Pharaoh, and the god Amun. That means that he has a divine parentage. His mother is Mut, and his father is Amun. It's his spiritual parent. And this is the physical birth occurs in the peristyle area, in the second peristyle area. And this spiritual birth occurs in a room that is almost adjacent to the Holy of Holies. So it gives you an idea of what is supposed to be happening as you get closer to your spiritual awakening. You're supposed to have a spiritual birth and recognize your parentage as being your higher self, as being given birth to not by physical parents but by spiritual parents, and your spiritual parents are the high gods and goddesses. And there are high and low gods and goddesses. There are gods, local gods and goddesses of your city, of your community, and there are national gods and goddesses for the whole country, and there are cosmic ones for the whole universe, and so on and so forth. So you want to realize that you originate from the higher divine self. One of the wonderful areas that I was able to find. Now, on the next slide is one of my other favorite areas of the temple, and this is going to be one of the rooms that I'm going to be showing the special holographic effect. And for those who were there, I was showing the holographic, what I'm really referring to is in a more detailed way, the holographic convergence, where you have images, reverse images on either side of the wall, that if you were to bring out the raised reliefs, and these are raised reliefs also, And if you were to bring them out to the center of the room, you would have a complete picture with both sides of the picture. So there's a subtle projection out of the reliefs, whereby the energy of the divinities can be embodied in the iconography, but also can actually come out in a psychic life force projection. But we're gonna kind of discuss that more at the conference, and I'm actually gonna show you an animation of the relief coming to life and coming to the center of the room and how that looks, so you get a full idea of what that means. But here, several holographs. This is the Holy of Holies room, or the main Holy of Holies room, shall we say, of the Luxor temple. And you can see some holograms on this particular picture. I think I have another picture that shows the full room better. But here you can still see the, especially you can see Amsu. When you see the video, I'll be pointing to these more directly so that you can see exactly what a holographic animation. You'll be able to see, what I'm relating it to. The next picture, the next slide, is another one of my favorite areas. Well, this is the series of slides, which shows the inner hypostyle area, the inner peristyle area, rather. And especially when it's lighted in this way, this is actually also the area of the physical birth, where you come in through the front where we came in, and you are having a physical connection. Kind of the same way as we were discussing when Heru goes to the Heru temple and they have a kind of physical birth that is actually has patience and mystic implications. This is what is really happening is that your physical nature is coming into alignment with the energies of the temple, and you're coming into a temple birth of your physical existence. Your physical existence is coming into a temple birth, or a spiritual kind of inclination, or alignment, attunement, any of those words you want to use. So you can go in further to the hypostyle area and to the spiritual birthing area, and finally to the Holy of Holies, where you do, and that's the area where we showed some wonderful Hetep relief on the outside portions of the Holy of Holies. I'm not sure everyone remembers that, but maybe we'll show some pictures next time. So this is it. We sat down here. And we had a little talk about some of these things I'm talking about now. And so the next two slides have more images of the peristyle area. And now moving towards this one slide that after the peristyle area. We're moving to the, it's starting to get to twilight. And so on this particular temple, we were able to go there during the day, late afternoon, and then we stayed through twilight into the evening. And here you can see the row of sphinxes that's been reconstructed. This would have been a 2 mile long stretch of sphinxes and a causeway that leads to the center of the temple. And I have one picture. The first one shows the pylons lit up. If you're looking in the other direction, towards the other temple, this is, if you were walking on this causeway for 2 miles, you would arrive at the next temple. And so now, the next slide, looking when it's fully dark, and the temple is lit. And we were on our way leaving at this point from the temple. On the next day, we went to the temple of Hatshepsut. Hatshepsut was also a Ptah. She also happened to be a female, a regent, a queen. And Pharaoh, and actually, the last time I went, the temple was being reconstructed or renovated, and area that we were walking up here now, it was closed off, and I went there back in 2000, and for the whole year, I went there three times that year, and for the whole time, it was closed off. So this was a treat for me to be able to go and see you can see the bottom floor. You know, you can walk through there, but you cannot go to the second level. The second level contains this is kind of interesting design also. It's something like Abu Simbel, whereas it's cut into the mountain in the back of the temple. So this is a kind of an open court. And here you have a ramp going up to the second level, and that second level is a kind of combination peristyle and hypostyle area, and behind in the back of the peristyle area is the next flight where you go upstairs. I'm showing a row of Hasarian columns, which you can see the front of as we're walking up on the previous slide, and then on the next slide you can see a close-up of the Hasarian columns. And this is a particular style of column that you can see in the Abu Simbel temple, and you see it again in Abdu and in some different places. And this is the standard iconography of the god Asar, who is standing in mummified form with a crook and a flail. Here you can see some of the paint where he is also red. But he is also, in this context, he is also an image of the Ptah as well, of the pharaoh. The king or queen. Now, in the next slide, Sebai is there kneeling in front of the entrance to the Holy of Holies, the Temple of Hatshepsut. And if you were to walk through the door, you're going into the back end and into the mountain. So it's something very similar to the Abu Simbel Temple. And that's what I was saying. This is a kind of combination of peristyle area. This is a kind of another open court. We walk through a kind of sort of hypostyle area that goes into another open court, and this is where you come into. And there are some rooms to the either side as well. And we didn't have much time to look. And this is on the west bank of the Nile now. This is the Luxor temple where we were previously was on the east bank, and now we're on the west. And this is the area that contains the Valley of the Kings and also several other temples, like the Ramesseum and Medinet Abu, and some of them that we did not see, which you can spend more time in Egypt and go to see. So really, Luxor, they say, contains like 80% of the temples and artifacts. And so theoretically, one could go through a whole trip that we did, but also spend a whole week in Luxor to really see everything in a more detailed and more impactful manner. So it all depends on how much time is placed on each site. On the next slide, we see these images come from the bottom floor, the chapel of Heteru. And so again, you know, we have the concept of a chapel within a temple of a higher context. And this one is more of a dedication to Amun and Asar, where you have the Heteru energy, and also you have Anpu energy. There are two chapels on either side of the temple, one for Heteru and one for Anpu. And the next slide the next two slides actually have some imagery of Hatshepsut's contribution to her legitimacy and her ethical standard. And I talk about this a lot, I think, during the trip. There's a kind of, when you see imagery of the pharaoh who is making war or who is fighting against animals, it should not be confused with the kind of idea of a warmongering culture the way we have now in Washington, you know, an empire. It's the idea of subduing unrighteousness and being strong enough to uphold truth, MAA, and that would give legitimacy. And so her truth was in establishing commerce, establishing peaceful connections with other nations, and bringing prosperity to Kemet. And these are some of the processions, images of the processions, and images of the commerce that was going on. And her reign was renowned for this and the prosperity that it brought. And then I think the final slide has an image of the god Anpu, and this is on the other end of the hallway, and the other end of that ramp that goes upstairs. So if you go to either side, you go to the chapel of Heteru or the chapel of Anpu. Of course, Heteru relates to energies that we discussed earlier of passion and of feline energy, leonine energy, as well as Heteru is a, her very name symbolizes an enclosure. It symbolizes creation in which the spirit resides. And on this other end, Anpu symbolizes energies of an earthly nature that relate to honing of senses, as well as having a right mind, having a healthy mind, energies of being able to discern truth from untruth, and to be able to find the way that leads to enlightenment. And so you have, I'm just giving broad strokes, because there are some other relations that have to do with the positioning and the architecture on either side of the temple and different aspects like that, but just giving broad strokes as to the fundamental aspects of their meaning. They have much more nuanced and detailed aspects. but we're giving just a kind of overview of what actually is supposed to be happening to the personality as one not only comes to view these iconographies, but also takes part in them through the holographic convergences and through the enactment of the ritual of offering, which they are plentiful. And right in the last slide, you can see one in front of Ampu, where the Pará is making an offering with two jars. This temple also is important in that it you can see the different style of columns that are used. There are some square ones in the previous slide, and there are some here that, you know, very ancient and more reminiscent of the later Greek style, but the Doric style of columns that became popular in Greece later, you know, much later. And this particular kind of architecture for this temple is not unique, but it is special in its construction. So for next time, I'll have these, the numbering system did not come out, and I was kind of rushed to throw them onto the website, but I'll have the numbering system, corrected for next time as well, so we can see better, but hopefully I give a description, and I'll be, on the video, I'll be pointing to the things that I'm relating, so they'll be easier to follow and see. So, and that video will be added to the playlist probably by tomorrow or the next day. Okay, so we'll leave it there for today. That's it.
You've been listening to the Temple of Aset, the teachings of Shatat Netter Internet Radio Blog Show. You have just heard Dr. Mawada Ashby, Sebai Ma, share part two, essentially, of his reflections from the 2015 spiritual pilgrimage to the ancient site of Kemet. He began his reflections 2 weeks ago and continued them this evening and will do so completely within the next two Saturdays. Dua, which means adoration, but we use it for saying thank you to all of you in our live and tape broadcast and listening audience. Until we meet again, which will be next week at the same time, on this same link, feel free to go to the www.egyptianyoga.com/trip to Kemet and look at last week's or 2 weeks ago's previous reflections by Sebai Ma. It is archived there. That way you'll be able to see the slides also. If you just want to listen to it, the broadcast is archived on the Blog Talk radio link. So until then, we say Dua to you again, and we say one of the ancient Kemetic proverbs: remember until we meet again to give thyself to God, keep thou thyself daily for God, and let tomorrow be as today. Peace and blessings, everyone. Until next week, the test. Do us a bye.
Thank you.